It's not enough. That's what we hear from the man in our text for today. Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. You know that's what he's really saying. It's not fair. He didn't give me enough. He cheated me. First century words from a selfish and greedy man, perhaps. And yet words that are strangely familiar to us also in the 21st century, right? Words we hear all the time. It's not enough, said the drifter as he plodded his way through the streets, collecting old soda cans. It's cold and there's no place to stay, and everything I own is contained in this little bag. I have no job, no friends, no food. Not enough. Down the street, another man. It's not enough, he said, as he sat at his table staring at the gas bill. I live in a bad neighborhood. My check from the government barely covers the utilities. My children are running around in shreds of clothing. I can't find a job anywhere. No one's willing to help me. It's not enough. From a shop worker somewhere else. Three little children keeping my wife at home, inflation rising, a heavy-duty mortgage, doctor visits, formula, and diapers. How can I keep myself from getting too deeply into debt? It's not enough. From the lips of another middle-aged engineer. Oh, college tuition for my kids, the second car for my wife, and the new addition to the house. I am strapped. It's not enough. From a retiree. My husband passed away. My Social Security and pension hardly allow me to enjoy the type of life that we once had. I can't help out my children as much as I'd like. It's not enough. And finally, one more, the corporate executive. It's just not enough. A big mortgage on my summer cabin, dock space for my boat, insurance on the Porsche, golf memberships for the boys. Hardly seems like there's anything left over. Enough is a term that is not easily defined, as you can tell from these very divergent examples. For some, enough means barely scraping through till the next day. For others, it means having to make do with a two-year-old car. For some, it means wearing tattered clothing and accepting welfare from the government. For others, it means dipping into the nest egg they have at the bank. Funny thing is, though, that almost no matter who you talk to, whatever their station in life, whatever they have managed to accumulate for themselves, enough is never really considered enough. It is altogether insufficient. Too little, we say, to give us the security that we can freely share it. Too little, we say, to enable significant reaching out. For you see, we push ourselves and stretch ourselves to the limit. We take what we have and we spread it and use it to purchase as much as we can for ourselves. And in the end, because of the commitments we make and the ambitions and cravings we have, we always seem to feel just a little bit strapped. Nothing left over. I know yesterday there was a big jackpot, right? $400 and some odd million, am I right? Why do you think people are running after that? Why does the number just keep going up and up and up? Because enough is really not enough. We want that. In our text for this morning, the Lord Jesus responds to the dissatisfied man in the crowd and ultimately to us. He begins by speaking a warning. Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Indeed, Jesus knew well how the cry, "It's not enough," could easily lure his people into discontent and dissatisfaction, which can drive out the Spirit of God and leave in its wake a trail of jealousy, envy, dishonesty, and lust. He knew how empty human pursuits would be without a relationship to the Creator of the universe. Listen to the writer of Ecclesiastes for a good example. King Solomon says, My heart began to despair over all my toilsome labor under the sun. What does a man get for all his toil and anxious striving? This is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Solomon had lost his focus, and things became about things instead of about his relationship to God. Jesus doesn't stop there. He then goes on to share a parable to give us as God's people a proper perspective on possessions and goods. His message in the parable, the things we have in this life, whatever they are, have been provided for us not just by our own ingenuity, not just by our hard work and industry, not just by our cleverness and acumen, but ultimately by God himself. He is the one who has given us the talents and abilities we have in order to earn a living. He is the one who has brought our families to a land with a high standard of living and has enabled us to keep up. He is the one who has blessed our investments, kept us in good health, and been there whenever the extra nudge was needed to make ends meet. As I said to the children, all that we are and all that we have are truly gifts from him. Notice where the rich man in the text gets the wealth. It says, the ground produced. That is, God was gracious and gave him a good crop. But the man completely turns the tables. Did you see what he did? He says this is what I will do. Notice the eyes and minds. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my grain and my goods, and then I'll say to myself, you've got plenty of good things laid up for yourself. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. It doesn't take a wizard to see who's the focus of this man's attention. And Jesus wants his people to realize that God is our provider, our ever-present source of blessing. And he can give, and he can take away. Finally, then, beyond our text, Jesus goes one step further. He declares that not only have all good things we possess been provided by God, but they still, even now, belong to him. We are given these things on loan, so to speak, and are expected to use them in ways that please God and give honor to him. So we are accountable to God in the way we use the things that he has entrusted to our care. To him who has been given much, much is required, says Jesus. Now, all this is very sobering, I think, especially when we compare our priorities so often with the priorities of our Heavenly Father. Consider, for instance, what he did for us in Christ Jesus. There he was on his heavenly throne, with all glory, power, and honor. And there we were, a lowly creation who had gone so far astray that it would cost him dearly to win us back. Anyone else might have given up. They would have counted the cost and considered it too high, not worth the personal sacrifice. They would have scrapped the whole human race and started from scratch. But God's first priority was not his own comfort, not his own glory, not his own power. It was us. And he was willing to stretch even his own inexhaustible limits to their fullest extent, so that we might live forever free of the bonds of sin and death. Christ was a highman. He had to give up his perfect and only son into a world filled with sin. He had to subject his son to brutal torture and unspeakable scorn. He had to lay on that son as a sacrifice the sin of all generations. And he had to watch that son be crucified by people who barely seemed to care. But for God, that's the love he had for his people. And it so moved him that no price was too high. And Jesus willingly and voluntarily bore our sin and punishment so that we might have love. Can you see what I mean when I talk about the sharp contrast between the priorities of God and the priorities of humans? He gave up everything he had to care for his people. He sacrificed what was most valuable so that they might know life and forgiveness. And yet here we sit in a world filled with hunger, poverty, disease, and strife, living in a land that is well known for its prosperity, surrounded by innumerable blessings and countless conveniences, and we say, it's not enough. I walked into my house the other day, because I too have said those words. I looked around me. I considered the needs of people around the world, and I could scarcely believe that I've ever said such a thing. I have a house to enter, luxury many in the world do not have. It's a nice house, plenty of room, warm and cozy, or maybe today I should say, cool and comfortable. Plenty of amenities, TVs, DVD players, music, dishwasher, microwave oven, washer, dryer, garbage disposal, shower, and more toys than I can count. I have two cars, one for me and for Amy. My cupboards and closets are never lacking. Plumbing, indoor plumbing, a blessing. Electricity, I could go on and on. All that I need is right there. How different from so many in the world. And as I took stock of my many blessings and considered my frequently casual indifference toward those whose needs surpass my own, I began to feel a bit like the foolish man in the parable. Here I am with so much, whining and dining, so to speak, with the things God has entrusted to me, filling up a storehouse, while others around me, both near and far, are struggling, starving, and dying, and desperately need a portion of my plenty in order to survive. Somewhere, somehow, God's priorities can so easily get mixed, and we can just end up living for ourselves in a materialistic society. And when I thought about his words, from everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded, and when I considered all that he had done for me, I hung my head for a moment as one so richly blessed and who had so often failed to use my plenty to help others in need. And I thank God for his generosity. And I thank God for his love. And I thank God for his forgiveness for me, for my selfishness. And I vow again to continue to keep my eyes focused out. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as God's people who have received so much from our Lord, maybe it's good for all of us frequently to take a second look at what we have and recognize that we are entrusted with his gifts to use to his glory. The world will always say, keep, 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 it's all about me. God's Spirit, however, is so much stronger than our indifference. And as we cling to him in faith, he will indeed move in our hearts to work in us the attitude and priorities that God desires. And we will reach out to make a difference by making use of such things as food collections, world hunger agencies, disaster relief funds, and the like, to touch the world with the soothing, saving message of Jesus. May God make us all a bit more thankful for what we have. And may God bless us all to be generous.